Yeah, it works. So so basically continue following the topic Charlie discussed in the morning. So here I will discuss some advances in electronics, nano-electronic devices that can be used to both augment the brain, hopefully one day, and also maybe some people may use it to compete with the brain. So we'll see which one wins. So the idea is to build electronic devices that can really emulate the brain. So we're not trying to do it in software. We're actually trying to build it at the fundamental device and hardware level, build a network very similar to the biological neural network. Okay, so I'll discuss how we are going to do that. So there's obviously a lot of interest in that. So first we know is the topic of artificial intelligence, right? So a lot of you guys probably heard the news that this is very big, so people tell me that now cab drivers in Seoul, they also know they are starting in deep learning because this game Google played with the Go player in Seoul is huge, it's big news. And it actually Google, the artificial intelligence system beat the human champion, right, in 5 games. This was not thought possible until decades later, but already with the advances in software and in electronics, we can actually beat people in this very complex game. But if you look at carefully, we are not playing a fair game. So Google, for the system Google uses, they use more than 1,000 CPUs and more than 100 GPUs. Okay, these things consume lots of power, much more power than a human brain consumes, right? So it's not a fair game in some sense. So you can argue that Google beat the human by brute force, by advances in electronics. And the other thing that this things can do one thing well. So the artificial intelligence system does one thing well. In this case, it studies the game well, but it takes a very long time to train. It takes them 3 weeks and over 340 million steps to train the system just to do this one task. But if you ask this system to do another task, to drive a car, it will get completely lost, right? So that's another limitation of this system. So it's software-based, it's not very efficient, okay? And also, it's really focused on one task. It's not general purpose, like a biological system. So this is another example. This is actually my favorite example, right? That's another DARPA project I was involved a few years ago. This is a work by IBM in the same project. So in this project, we're asked to try to build a system that can emulate the complexity of a cat brain. So this is what IBM did. So they use this a supercomputer system 147,000 CPUs and 144 terabyte of memory to emulate a cat brain. It's not even live cat. It just emulates 100 million neurons in the system. So the 100 million neurons doesn't really work together, so it's not a live cat. But still, it takes them so much power to just emulate the system. And you can still only do that at almost 100 times slower speed. So it's not even real-time speed. So the reason is that, once again, this is because we try to emulate the system in software. We don't have this efficient hardware to do to emulate the biological system. So the idea is that if we can build a hardware that can actually also implement some of the rules, the algorithms, or the features we learn in biology, that not only will make computers faster, but also maybe you can use it to couple with biological systems to enhance our brain function better as well. So this is one photo I took from one of Ken's review papers published in 2008. So here, this is a well-known Michigan probe, right? So if you look at the probe, as Ken said yesterday, quoted from an unknown source, so hopefully you can find out the source. So neuroscience is data-rich, right? We can have a lot of data. Now people talk about thousands of sites, right? So you can collect a lot of data. But how do you process the data? How do you make sense of the data? That's still a challenge. So right now, for example, we have a lot of data. We have 1,000 channels. But we collect the data here. We process the data at somewhere else. So this is already the newest generation. Before, we have to connect it to a computer. But now we can do a lot of processing here. But still, between the data collection and data analysis, you need this high-speed cabling between them. So yesterday, we saw data that you need the cabling with a bandwidth of more than a gigabit per second, right? So these are all challenges. But the question is that, what do you do with the data? So if you can build systems that can very efficient system that can directly respond to the biological system. So the idea is that biological signals, maybe you can process the data right at the probe. You don't have to transmit the data. You only transmit the sensible data or some information you extracted from the data to this bulkier electronics or eventually to the computers. That actually you can process the data locally. Maybe you can use the data to also store some information and maybe use it to stimulate the biological system. So that's the other possible direction. So not only can we use it to compete with brains, but maybe also we can use it to enhance the brains. So how do we do that? Well, the challenge, obviously, is because the brains are very different from computers, right? So in a brain, we have this network, and we have neurons and synapses. And it turned out that the neurons are not a problem. So our neurons are complex, but it's not. We don't have too many neurons. We have 100 billion neurons in a human brain. We have about 100 million neurons in a cat brain. So a cat can already do a lot of things we can't do with a computer, right? But we already have billions of transistors in a very tiny Pentium chip. So these are not, so the neurons are not the problem. And the problem is actually the synapses, right? Because we all know in biology, one neuron is connected on average 10,000 other neurons through the synapses. And the synapse really form the network. And that's where we store the information and where we process the information, because the strength of the synapse modulates how the information is passed from one neuron to the next neuron. Okay, so this network is really enabled by the synapses, and we really don't have a method to build this network because we don't have a good device to emulate the synapses. So what we need, if you examine this problem, is that a synapse is really a two-terminal device. It connects a pair of neurons, right? It's two-terminal. It has a parameter, we call it a weight, a synaptic weight, which changes over time, so it can modulate a signal propagation between the neurons. So if you want to build an electronic version of this device, you need this two-terminal device. In this case, it's electronic, so the signal can be a current. So the Hood conductance can change over time, so Hood conductance we can modulate, but it also needs to have a memory effect. So with this type of device, if you can identify such a device, then you can build this network kind of similar to a biological network at the fundamental device level. So you can have your neurons, these are your transistor-based neurons that are connected to each other through this electronic version of the synapses. Okay? So you can build a network with the desirable connectivity similar to the biological networks. Later on, I will show that we do have these devices, and not only do they look like a synapse, they can behave like a synapse. They also offer some very interesting temporal dynamics, very similar to the intrinsic properties of synapse. So we may be able to use them to actually study or directly coupling or study some neuroscience problems. So this device, I think, as was introduced earlier, is called we call it a memory star, or some people call it a resting memory. So it's basically, as I said, it's the two-terminal device. It looks like a resistor. That's what you need. But a normal resistor is trivial. It doesn't do anything, right? You can put a resistor in a network, you can't change it. These devices, you can change the resistance on the fly in situ. But after you change it, they can learn a new resistance, then they will remember this new resistance for a very long time. So how do we do that? Well, the idea is that you can't do that by just moving electrons. You actually have to move ions in this case. So that's also similar. So in biology, in a real synapse, we change the synaptic weight through ions, although a real synapse is much more complex. So here you can consider it as a performance version of the synapse. So this is one example. So we start with the best insulator. For example, a silicon dioxide. Okay, it's the best insulator you can get. Then what you can do is that you put a so-called active electrode. For example, in this case, we use a silver electrode. All you need to do is then applying a field. So by applying this field, you can oxidize this silver into a silver ion. Then this ion can migrate under this electric field and eventually become reduced into a silver atom again. And over time, you have silver atoms being removed from this electrode and being deposited over the other electrode. And over time, it will form a filament. So in the end, the resistance of the device is no longer determined by the bulk property of silicon dioxide, but short passed by this silver filament. Okay. You can repeat this process or create the inverse process by dissolving this filament. So by doing that, you can change the resistance of this device from the best insulator to the best conductor, okay? And you can do it very reliably over millions of cycles, okay? So this is one type. We also started another type, similar idea. So instead of using a silicon dioxide and silver, here we use oxide material, like for example, tantalum oxide or hafnium oxide, which is also a very common semiconductor material. So for example, hafnium oxide is a very good insulator. But if you remove some oxygen ions from it, you create a so-called hafnium suboxide. This suboxide is conductive. Okay? So when in the beginning we have a suboxide, we have this hafnium oxide. So by applying electric field, we remove some oxygen ions. So we create this suboxide. Now this whole device becomes conductive. Okay? We can reverse this process and recover this insulating state. So once again, we can recycle this device from the high resistance state to low resistance state over millions of cycles or hundreds of millions of cycles. So in this sense, you can see these are new devices because they are electronic devices, but the device operates not only by electron current, you actually have to change the materials. So you can argue during the device operation, we are physically changing the material. In this case, we physically created this filament. We physically moved the masses through the dielectric. In this material, we physically move the ions. So we're physically changing the property of the materials by moving the ions. So these are obviously cartoons. So we have done a lot of devices, but finally, recently, we were able to get the direct evidence to show this picture is actually correct. It's not just a hypothesis. Okay? This is a lot of times where you get the data first, eventually you figure out the mechanism. So this is one study we did. So how do this filament form in this solid state, right? And you can understand them move in liquid, but how do they move in this silicon dioxide, for example? So what we did here is that we embed the silver particle in this silicon dioxide. We put two electrodes across it. We put this whole device inside the TEM. So there's nothing connected to this particle. It's fully isolated. The only thing it sees is the electric field, okay? So by applying this electric field, so what you can see is that this particle then starts to dissolve. So it gets smaller and smaller over time. So what happens is that, I'll stop here. So obviously you can't move the whole particle through this solid state medium. So what happens is that you oxidize one atom at a time. So you oxidize this atom, you create an ion. Then you move this ion some distance, it reaches another stable state, it will become reduced here and become reduced into a silver atom. Then this process is just repeated. So over time, the original particle becomes smaller and smaller. So it's in the end, by just applying an electric field, we are really moving individual atoms. So we are controlling the motion of individual atoms, which is quite surprising to me because in the past, people talk about building circuits with atoms. You have to do it at very low temperature using, at high vacuum using scanning tunneling microscope. So here we do things at room temperature in a complete circuit. So you can complete your circuit and room temperature, all you need to do is just apply 1 volt or 2 volts across the device. And you can do this in a controlled fashion at room temperature, okay? In a completed circuit on the fly. So this is what happens. So over time, eventually this original particle will disappear and this new particle will form. So over time, you move this particle from one location to another. So there's actually a lot of interesting dynamics in the process. So to move this particle, this atom need to be ionized first. So there's an oxidation process. Then it need to migrate through the dielectric. So there's ion migration process. Then it will become reduced at the other end. So there's a reduction process. So there's a volume expansion of this filament growth. There's temperature can affect the process. So there's quite a lot of processes that can be involved. So it looks very simple, looks very simple from outside, just the resistor, but in fact, there's a lot of complex dynamic processes, and that this process can be affected by the electric field, which is the main factor, but can also be affected by temperature, and also obviously material properties. So we have done a lot of modeling analysis, trying to understand the different parameters on the device behavior and the dynamic growth process of the filament, and the goal is to not only use this to improve the device performance, but also to map some of the equations, which I will show later, that to the biological system. Because you can argue that if you write down the equations, some of the equations looks very similar to people derived for the synaptic change equations, for example, calcium ion based learning rules. So they actually look very similar. So not only do they function similarly, but they may be driven by similar dynamics. So that's basically the idea for this study. So this is a device after programming, you can see the filament being formed, okay? But the more interesting behavior is in between, so the dynamic growth process. So this is a device. After device fabrication, we can integrate it on top of CMOS neurons. For example, you can build CMOS neurons, and you can build this crossbar array. And the idea, once again, is that you can put the neurons on the periphery, then at each cross point, you have this two-terminal device, and you can build your network, okay? So in this study, we use them mostly as a memory. So the first application people are interested in is memory application, because memory is a very large market, 60 billion market, right? So there's a lot of interest in what's going on, what will happen after flash. So a lot of companies are very interested in this. Just to show that moving ions, people have started this for many, many years, right? It seems like a crappy process, but it's actually very repeatable, very well-controlled process. So this is not something that just we publish papers at a university and then we forget about it. It's actually very reliable. So to show that, first, all the major semiconductor companies, they have an effort on this type of device. And we also were able to convince some VCs to help us create a company. And it was founded in 2010 and has grown to over 50 employees in the Bay Area. And we have fortunately received over 85 million VC funding up to date. So this is a complete circuit, so in a commercial fab. So this is an 8-inch fab in the beginning. So the last year we have been doing it on 12-inch fabs in some of the best, largest fabs in the world. Okay, so this is actually not something completely we just discuss and publish papers. It's actually seeing that you learn from science that actually hopefully can be commercialized, and we already have products made for several customers on the market. Okay, so this is done at the 40 nanometer technology node on the 12-inch wafers. So just to show, it's quite reliable. Okay, the process. But in this talk, I will focus on the neuromorphic applications. So for that, we focus on this oxide-based device. The reason is that with this oxide, for example, tantalum pentoxide, we can just move a little bit of oxygen ions. So by removing a little amount of oxygen ions, you can increase the conductance slightly. So by controlling how much oxygen you remove, or how many oxygen ions you remove from this layer, you can control the conductance incrementally in a very well-controlled fashion. So once again, we can do very detailed molecular dynamics simulation to simulate this relative change, and there's really no adjustable parameter, so everything is known from the bulk. So we just describe the ion migration that leads to the change in the resistance in a well-controlled, predictable fashion. The nice thing with this oxide-based device is that the conductance not only jumps, it can be changed incrementally, as I mentioned earlier. So in this case, we apply a chain of pulses. Each pulse has an identical shape. So each pulse will only increase the conductance incrementally. Okay, so that's the idea behind using these devices to do neuromorphic computing, is that in neuromorphic computing, you want the weights to increment to change incrementally. So with that, we can train the weights incrementally, so we can implement learning on the fly in the circuit. Okay. So this first work we did in 2010, just to show we can use these devices, look at the scale, obviously it's very different. So this is the electronic version of the synapse, hopefully. So we can use this device to emulate a spike timing dependent plasticity, which obviously we know is very important learning rule in biology. So here we show that we can get the same behavior or similar behavior in this solid state devices. So the idea is then to build a network of these devices. So for different applications. So primarily we are funded to do one application, which Charlie mentioned, is to replace the brain. I don't know if it's possible, but we want to do computing tasks very efficiently. So one important task is obviously image analysis. So one project we focused on is doing image processing. So the idea is very simple. So obviously from my rudimentary understanding of neuroscience is that what we call intelligence is based largely on pattern matching, right? So in fact, people argue that what we say learning is basically recognizing the pattern. We learn the pattern in the past and we release the pattern to the current situation. That's how we perform learning. So it's all based on pattern matching. So the same principle is applied to this device. So we just build this crossbar structure with each device at a cross point, right? So we feed the input into these rows. These are our input neurons. We get the output from those output neurons, okay? So for example, if the input is an image, so we represent each pixel with a voltage pulse. So I have a device here, so this voltage pulse is converted to a current output through the device conductance, okay? So basically the current output is then simply this voltage multiplied by the conductance, right? So we perform this multiplication. But what we have is that we have a vector coming in. So we have a vector coming in, we get a vector coming out. So this vector coming out is then the product of this voltage vector of this weight matrix. In fact, it's the dot product of this input vector with weight matrix. Then we get this current output vector. Okay? So this is actually turned out to be a fundamental operation for a lot of the machine learning and also big data tasks. Everything can be reduced to this matrix dot product operations. In fact, that's what MATLAB does, is matrix dot product operations, and you can build a general purpose computer with MATLAB, right? So you can reduce a lot of the tasks to this dot product operations, and in this case, we perform this dot product operation not in a digital processor, we perform it, you can argue it, in physics. So we use the resistance to directly perform the dot product, and we use basically Ohm's law to perform the dot product. We use Kirchhoff's law to perform the summation of this vector product, vector matrix product. Okay. So we do this computation in physics. So in the end, you get this result by performing a single operation. So all we need to do to get this dot product is perform an read operation. We just read the current. That's the result we expect from dot product. Okay. Mathematically, this is what we perform through a single operation, which is obviously different from a digital processor, okay? So the other thing that when you look at the dot product, if you look at this particular neuron, then the output of this particular neuron output is then the dot product of the input with the weights stored in this column, right? So once again, the dot product is maximum when these two vectors are aligned, when they are parallel. Once again, this is a pattern matching task, right? If they are aligned, if they are matched, then you get the maximum dot product. So that's, once again, how we perform this pattern matching network task in hardware. So we perform this task in at the board level. So we build these 32 by 32 crossbars. These are experimental results showing we can train the weights incrementally. We also perform very detailed simulation, including device variability to show the circuit works well. So we train the network with this non-randomly chosen natural images. So these are natural images because they don't have very abrupt and natural changes, right? But there are common features in those natural images. So the idea is to, just like in the visual cortex, so each neuron has a receptive field associated with a neuron, so that a neuron is particularly sensitive to one pattern. So the idea is to, we'll be able to extract those receptive fields in these artificial neurons. All the receptive fields stored in the memory star array associated with the artificial synapses. So these are the results obtained through training. So we start with random weights, then we feed the image to the network, then if the input pattern matches with one vector here, for example, this neuron will fire, then we use a simple Hamming rule to update the weights to enhance this match, okay? So in the beginning, the weights are completely random just by chance, some neurons will fire first because this better matching with the pattern, then over time, this match will be improved. So over time, we'll see that the receptive fields will evolve into this basically very similar receptive fields people found in visual cortex neurons. Okay, and with that, we can use learned receptive fields to perform image reconstruction. So the idea is that you don't have to process image pixel by pixel. You can just identify which features are there in the image, then you can reconstruct the image much more efficiently. In fact, you can also do classification in these learned features rather than in the original image. People have shown you can do this also very efficiently. So this is another example where we can improve this performance even better. So this is a typical image people use in a machine learning community. This is a simulated result, but the actual chip will be delivered later this year. So in this community, people know a lot about PCA, right? Principal Component Analysis. So for example, in this study, we used Wisconsin Hospital breast cancer database. So to test a cell is a cancer or normal cell, you don't subject it to one test, you subject it to a series of tests. Each test give you a score. So the idea is to cluster, to be able to separate those two groups. So if you project the data along any axis, the data will be mixed because each test is not efficient. So the principal component analysis is that you want to learn the principal components. Basically, these are the engine vectors of the matrix. Then you project the data along the engine vectors. Then you will be able to separate the two groups, right? So you can solve the engine vectors by solving the matrix directly using MATLAB, or you can use a machine learning algorithm to learn the engine vectors. So we basically use the network to learn the engine vectors and perform this clustering problem as well. So this original data, obviously, is completely mixed. The color actually are not used. The label are not used in our process. They are just used to highlight the mixing of the data and the separation of the data afterwards. Okay. Okay, the last couple minutes, what I will discuss is something I feel even more interesting maybe for this community is that these devices not only look like a synapse, what I hope is that they can also behave like synapse, and they also offer some interesting dynamics of the synapse. So one important learning rule of synapse is also obviously SDDP, but there are also other important rate-based learning rules. So there's a lot of studies or debate on how the synapses remember timing, right? What makes the timing important, right? Because the biological system doesn't have a global clock. How do we remember timing? How does the timing affect the synaptic weight change? So obviously a synapse is much more complex than just having a weight. It really has like hundreds of proteins and very different dynamic processes going on inside to make the weight change. So so here we follow a model by Bayer and Leon Cooper, and where they argue that, so this is obviously taken from Neuroscience 101 book. So they argue that the synaptic weight change is obviously determined by the activity of the receptors. But this activity of the receptor is in turn determined by, for example, calcium ion concentration, which also offers some interesting dynamics. So in this model by Bayer and Cooper, what they argue is that when the first synapse coming in, so it generates a postsynaptic potential, right? There's a depolarization field. So this field has a very long tail. So after the snap is a spike is gone, this potential still has a long tail. So if the presynaptic spike comes in before this tail, then these two depolarization fields can overlap. So they can add up. So that can increase the calcium concentration above a threshold that can cause potentiation. If the postsynaptic spike is after this postsynaptic spike, then they add up differently, so that leads to different calcium concentration. Okay, so even though the spikes don't overlap, they create some internal short-term dynamics. These short-term dynamic effects overlap, and this decay basically effect has a constant time constant that effectively, from an engineering point of view, it behaves like a provides a timing mechanism. Because this exponential decay is, you can use it to measure time. So that the neuroscientists don't see that, but from once again, I'm not a neuroscientist, so I was a physics in training. So from a physics or electroengineering point of view, this decay internal dynamics provides a timing mechanism. That's why the synapses can actually respond differently with spike timing dependent plasticity or rate dependent time plasticity. So we can implement this short-term dynamics in these devices as well, because the device movement, the ion movement is governed by some short-term dynamics. For example, you can, if you apply one voltage pulse, you can increase, for example, in this case, we use temperature. You can increase temperature temporarily. This temperature will decay, will be done. Then the next pulse coming in, if the temperature hasn't decayed completely, then it can enable synaptic training, can enable the ion movement. If the other pulse comes in too late, it doesn't, it will not be able to enable the ion change or ion movement. Okay? So with that, we can implement STDP without any overlapping pulses or anything. We just use very simple spikes, very similar to a biological spike. We just run the spikes. These are actually experimental data. We just run the spike naturally through the device, and it will either increase the conductance or decrease the conductance based on the relative timing of the spikes. Okay. So that's what I feel interesting. This is showing the time dependence, rate dependence, okay, as well. So with the same device, same spikes, we can both get the spike timing dependent plasticity and the rate dependent plasticity. So you can also use the engineering material so that it can respond to signals almost the same as a real biological spike. So instead of volts, they can respond to pulses on the order of 70 millivolts, okay? And they can respond directly to the spike. So the hope is to integrate these devices directly with the biological probes, for example, developed here or at in our collaborators in Europe, or maybe with Charlie's group, so that they can directly respond to the biological steps and specs and store data, and we can use this device to store data and process the data very efficiently and locally. So this is done by my student Wen, and she had a poster outside discussing in more detail of this behavior. Okay. So I'll skip that. So I'll thank my students who did all the work. This is my group outside this beautiful facility we have at Michigan. This is the Lurie Nanofabrication Facility. Funding support, and also in the end, I'd like to thank Professor Lieber again. I was a postdoc in Professor Lieber's group from 2003 and 2005. So I learned a lot, both in terms of how to do science, but also how to be a scientist. So I really appreciate that. And that helped me kickstart my career. So thanks, Charlie, again.
Is a single cell, which was recorded by the Grand Truth. And these three subclusters needed to be merged manually in order to get good performance of this. If you do that manually,